This is an Audio Wool original.
This episode of Fright Day is brought to you by Springheel Jack Coffee. You need great coffee. Jack delivers. Visit springheeljack.coffee.
Hey guys, thanks for listening. If you'd like to support us, go to patreon.com/frightday.
Frightday. I'm your host, Byron.
Mm-mm.
Not today.
Mm-mm.
Not today.
Mm-mm.
So it's true. When all is said and done, grief is the price we pay for love. But as if loss and sorrow isn't enough, what about the secrets left behind? The ones without clear explanation. The darker, the more devastating. We'll talk about that. Lovely real estate and incomplete assignments reviewing David Bruckner's The Night House. I'm joined tonight by Kelly.
Mm-hmm.
And Sam can't make it because he's on the other side of the lake. I'm sorry, Kelly. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I had to tell you.
Yeah, I'm sorry. He's over there. Oops. Well, that's okay. It's fine.
Well, you got to quit wandering around in these woods. We'll talk about that.
Yeah, we will talk about that.
Kelly, that's it. You're not looking great. For the past 4 months... Seems like something's been wrong.
No, I am good.
Are you going to be all right? Are you doing okay?
I'll be fine.
You look exhausted.
Yeah. You know. I think they might have planted something in me when they did my surgery.
No, they didn't put... No, they didn't. They didn't, did they?
Hearing some things.
All right. Recently. I think that's called PCP.
Some feedback. I would never do PCP. Can somebody explain to me, though, how people are accidentally taking fentanyl?
I don't know what you mean by that.
This big article about how most of the overdoses of fentanyl...
Mostly accidental because drug dealers are putting it into things.
But why? It's cheaper than other stuff?
Yes, but they don't quite understand
That's
dosing.
A really bad, like,
it's bad business
strategy.
Because you want to keep your clients
alive.
If they
die, you can't make money from
Listen
them.
Up. Drug dealers out there, knock this off. All right, I know
I've just been thinking a lot about this because both Mayor of Easttown and American Rest had a lot to do with the opioid epidemic, and so I'm like, you know,
what's that Midwest problem? You've been watching what? American Rust.
Jeff Daniels, doesn't he live in Montana?
I don't know if Jeff Daniels lives in Montana.
I feel like he does, doesn't he?
I don't know. Did you like that show?
Yeah, I mean...
I feel like I got enough with the mayor of Easttown.
Like it is a bit of a stretch, because it's not like an enjoyable show, but it was good.
What show are you on? You don't need to explain yourself.
Yeah, I mean, now I'm moving along. Now I'm on Succession. I'm going through my fourth viewing of Succession.
You know, this is weird. I feel like years ago, Kelly would have been already deep into her Christmasing.
No, I'm deep.
Okay, so never mind. You're just being responsible with what you're talking about on the show.
Oh, yeah. No, you want me to talk about that? I just finished watching Home Alone 2.
That's a great one. Lost in New York?
It is. You want to hear an amazing quote? Creature and Puck, you were watching it.
They do the Trump part?
Yep. Creature goes, Puck. Was Donald Trump.
Stop.
And you want to know what Pukwudgie said?
No, I don't actually. I don't want to cut.
She goes, you know, I think it's really great that he can be helpful sometimes. Because, you know, Kevin asks him which way to go.
Yeah,
and he points Kevin in the right direction.
Excuse me, where's the lobby?
Down the hall and to the left.
Thanks.
Yeah, and that was really kind of Donald Trump.
Puck's just trying to see the good in people.
That's really cool. Yeah,
she's very much a villain advocate. Across the board.
Look at me, though.
Are you a villain?
Remember my interview with Wayne Nance?
I didn't like that.
Yeah, it was not great.
I don't think we should even talk about that. Did you see, speaking of famous Montanans, did you see where...
Did you find out that Jeff Daniels lives in Montana?
He does live in Montana.
All right.
But, well, I mean, he has a home in Montana.
Are we talking about Taylor Swift and John Mayer? Do we really need to do this right now?
Yeah, but then did you see where...
No.
He, like, engaged in... Like, he actually responded to somebody.
We don't need to talk about
that. I just wondered, do you really want me to die?
Kelly, these copies of...
Famous Montanans?
Just Married aren't going to put themselves away.
Mm-mm.
It's time for staff picks.
They say so much, but they never tell you if it's any good.
E.T.'s mom in it?
The Howling Horror straight ahead.
Was that a Kutcher?
Yeah, it's Kutcher. I don't like it. I believe it was Brittany Murphy. Rest in peace. You watched that doc series about her death?
No, I'm kind of trying to decide whether I want to do my own report before watching it or whether I need to watch it first.
Well, I think it opened up some things, so you might want to.
Did it resolve things or did it like open up some new potential
questions?
Well, we
know the cause of death. It was, well, we'll talk about that when we cover it. But this isn't a horror film that I'm going to talk about. It's one of the...
Wait.
I'm sorry.
If I led with that, you'd be very upset with me.
I know, yeah.
Okay.
This is one of the most important films to me. Along with Twister and Congo, there's Daylight.
Wait, what the fuck? No.
Manhattan is an island. By day, the population grows to over 3 million people. And every evening, 3/4 of them leave the city. If you want to get off the island, you can go over the water or go under it. Tonight, however, commuters are advised to avoid the tunnel.
A group of armed robbers fleeing the police head for the New Jersey Tunnel and run right into trucks transporting toxic waste. The spectacular explosion that follows results in both ends of the tunnel collapsing, and a handful of people who survived the explosion are now in peril. Kit Latura is the only man with the skill and knowledge to lead the band of survivors out of the tunnel before the structure collapses. You know this film, right?
It's so fucking bad.
It's probably one of my favorite films of
so bad.
The mid to late 90s. It made me the guy I am today. Directed by Rob Cohen, a guy who before this gave us the story of the last dragon in Dragonheart. Other gems include the Fast and the Furious, Triple X, a couple of Rammstein music videos.
Selling the shit out of this.
A sequel of the Mummy. The Brendan Fraser one, and most recently, Hurricane Heist, which I actually did see as well.
Did you?
Yeah, it's a heist taking place in the middle of a hurricane.
Really? Yeah, it's kind of like how Sharknado, you have to explain what it's about because it's not evident from the title. Go ahead.
Don't need to be so mean.
Oh, man, I can't believe you're talking about this.
There's something about this director, Kelly.
Something?
Every single film that he's ever made is loud, fast, fun, and bullshit. I will never forget the moment when Kit... of course, played famously by Sylvester Stallone, cracked that glow stick while trapped in that tunnel, remember?
No, I have to say there was nothing about that movie that was memorable to me.
Well, you got to re-see the scene because I've mimicked it a million times in my childhood and a few times as an adult. It's got a Viggo Mortensen in there and Danielle Harris.
I didn't remember that Viggo was in it.
If you haven't just watched this dumbass movie... it's good to shut your brain off sometimes, Kelly.
Wow. I mean, now I'm really tempted because...
Because you need it.
Well, I thought that I was ready for exactly what I was going to say, but now I'm like, well, fuck.
Well, Nighthouse, Daylight.
My connection's better because my connection is through our main star, Rebecca Hall, because she's done some really fucking cool movies in her day.
Is it Christine?
No, it's definitely not that. No. I'm surprised you didn't do that.
I should have done the Christine Chubbuck story.
I was going to go for like her straight up horror movies, but if you're going off label, then like I want to do Prestige.
Oh, come on. Everyone's seen Prestige.
I feel like a lot of people haven't.
It's Academy Award winner.
Yeah, but it's like 15 years
old. Talk about your boring film everyone's talked about.
Okay, well, whatever. It's a really, 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 really good movie. I would argue one of the best. Okay, and fine. If you're not going to let me talk about it.
Tell me what it's about or any other details about it, other than saying it's really, 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 really good and the best?
It's got Bale.
Okay.
It's got Jackman. It's got Michael Caine. It's got magic.
So these are just elements.
And it's got Rebecca Hall.
Tell me what the movie is.
It's about a magician.
And why do you like it so much?
It's a twisty windy, and I love a twisty windy.
Okay, I like that.
Because David Bowie is in it, and he plays Tesla.
Rest in peace.
Both of them are both dead. Tesla and Bowie.
Yes, you're right. Yeah.
Michael Caine. Piper Perabo is in it.
Okay.
Remember her?
Uh-huh.
From, what was that?
What does this film make you feel? Does it have a glow stick snapping?
Curious.
Does it have a glow stick?
Makes me feel curious. And then at the end, it ties up in a big happy bow and makes me feel like all is right with the world.
Well, that's nice.
Okay. All right. But if you're not going to, if you're going to just like make me really not do much about that because you're saying that everybody's seen it, then I am going to talk about the awakening.
Miss Cathcart, I'm a history master at a boys' prep school. I was sent to request your help. You are a ghost hunter as well as an author.
You can't hunt what doesn't exist.
We think we have one that does.
We might want ghosts to be true. Doesn't mean they are.
These boys aren't worried about bumps in the night. They are frightened to death.
I know this place, and I don't hold with any ghostly nonsense.
Did any of you see this ghost boy for yourselves?
I did miss. It was on the upper corridor.
Let's see, shall we?
Magnetic field detector.
Those are footprint catchers.
Ghosts have footprints?
No, people pretending to be ghosts do.
I think a really cool spooky movie that Rebecca Hall did and didn't get a lot of play. It's 10 years old. It's directed by Nick Murphy. And it's kind of I would call it a gothic horror, but not as like gaudy. A gothic horror is like Crimson Peak. It's not like it's like more of an Emily Bronte gothic horror than like a...
I don't know what that is.
Author?
Oh, what's a...
Yep. Okay. It takes place right after World War I. It's basically like a early edition debunker.
Well, and she's kind of a ghost hunter.
Yeah, well, she's like a ghost debunker.
Oh, she's like
primarily.
She like, goes around and says, she's a Byron.
Yeah, sure. She goes around and she's like, yeah, this isn't really what's going on. Because it was during the time when, you know, there were a lot of mediums and spiritualism. She's basically taking it upon herself to crush out the evil people taking advantage of others. But it's a really cool, spooky movie. It's got some incredibly spooky moments in it. Very good acting. Very British. Like, very...
Really British. I wonder, super why is it so British? I wonder.
It takes place in Britain.
Yeah, and it is a British film.
Stars a lot of British people. Director's I'm pretty sure.
British.
Director is British.
Wow, that makes a British
The writer
film.
Was also British.
Oh, would you look at that. All the makings of a British film.
It's great, though. Very beautiful. Really cool cinematography. Amazing acting. There's some semi-weird sexual stuff in it that kind of weirded me out a little bit, but like just not because it was sexual, but just because it was kind of like out of nowhere in this movie. But it was the first time that Rebecca Hall showed up on my radar, and I remember watching this and saying, I recognize her from somewhere. What do I recognize her from? And then I was like, oh my God, she was in The Prestige. And then I realized that I loved her. And so now I just kind of keep my eye on her. And, you know, she was in The Gift, and she pops every once in a while in a really interesting movie. But she seems to do like a horror about every 5 years.
And they're usually pretty good.
They're really good. And she, I don't know, you don't count it as horror, but Tales from the Loop she was also in, which is super interesting. Hmm. Kind of like a almost Twilight Zone-y anthology that was on Amazon last year.
Want to hear something weird?
Yeah, what?
So I've never zoomed in on the poster of The Awakening. I've only seen it in thumbnail. I've always thought it was Mila Jovovich or whatever her name is.
You thought that that not thought Rebecca that, Hall,
that
you thought
image
it was Mila.
Looked like Mila to me.
So much fucking better than that one.
Well, yeah, I'm that's why I didn't watch it. Because
it's
I was
really
like,
good.
I don't want to see that.
It's really good. Highly recommend.
Wow.
Check it out. Great movie. Very good. Not many people, if you said Rebecca Hall, not a lot of people are going to recognize who you're talking about. But if you look at the movies she's chosen.
She's got she's beautiful, but she's got a plainness to her. That
British.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, it's the British in her.
I think that people don't really see her visually stand out as much.
Oh, I love
But
her.
She's got some pretty amazing moments. I think
she
she's
really
very
does. You remember
consistent.
The Town? She was in The Town.
Loved her in The Town. Yeah. Vicky Cristina, Barcelona.
Yep.
But of course, my favorite. Christine.
No, want nothing Chubbitt to do with that story. One, and I'll never watch that one.
Kelly, I'm going to lock up. You're not looking so good.
Yeah, you've told me like 7 times, you fucker.
Now you're peeking.
I'm peeking now.
Well, because you're yelling. You don't need to yell.
God, fucking damn it.
All right, well.
Do you know her dad was the founder of the Royal Shakespeare Company? I mean, she comes from like legit British acting roots. That's about as British acting as you can possibly get.
Well, let's talk about her a little bit more, I guess.
I mean, I do like this new movie she did very recently.
And
just came
kind
out.
Of, yeah. Oh, we're playing catch up from October while we review The Night House.
Night. hope you're enjoying your visit here this evening. Now, on with the show.
Don't do that. Please stop. The Night House is a 2020 psychological horror film directed by David Bruckner.
Jerry Bruckheimer.
Listen, man.
When you hear that, don't you want to just say Jerry Bruckheimer?
Yeah, but the thing is, we've probably covered two Bruckners at this point. I urge our listeners to go back. I guarantee you've said that every single time.
I have never claimed to not be predictable or redundant.
You know what is branding is what it is. It's good. Repetition.
Yeah, it is branding. That's right. Yeah. It's part of my plan.
Reeling from the unexpected death of her husband, Beth is left alone in the lakeside home he built for her. She tries as best as she can to keep together, but then the dreams come. Disturbing visions of a presence in the house call to her, beckoning with a ghostly allure, but the harsh light of day washes away any proof of a haunting. Against the advice of her friends, she begins digging into his belongings, yearning for answers. David Bruckner, born in Atlanta.
Hot Atlanta?
His dad was a detective, his mom was an ER nurse, so it's basically a...
So he does not come from British acting roots.
No, he's basically, his family was a plot point of a TV
Jerry
show.
Jerry Bruckheimer movie.
TV show like ER or SVU. I don't know about a Bruckheimer, but...
Had to work it in.
He attended the University of Georgia where he met actor A.J. Bowen. Well, he's an all-time favorite Bumble Gore guy. He's in House of the Devil.
Did you just say Bumble Gore?
Mumble... I hope I said Mumblegore.
I think you said Bumble. I'll be interested when you listen back to that because
yeah,
I'm 84% sure it was Bumble.
Yeah. Mumblegore. A.J. Bowen, House of the Devil, Horrible Way to Die, You're Next, The Sacrament. He also met a guy named Jacob Gentry, director of My Super Psycho Sweet 16. It's a series I know nothing about. And the upcoming film, Broadcast Signal Intrusion, which I watched as part of South by Southwest. It is fine.
Is it like about...
It's a little long. It's very... It looks good, and it's got some kind of creepy moments, but for the most part, I think it could have shaved off a solid 15, 20 off of it.
Yeah, you always say that about movies, though.
No.
You're pretty judgy about anything longer than about an hour and 23.
Hour 25, yeah.
Yeah. 25 with credits.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. They came together to make an anthology called The Signal in 2007. The concept came from a surrealist game called Exquisite Corpse.
I don't know anything about that.
Well, it's where multiple people collaborate in order to complete an art project. Years later, I don't know if you remember The Signal. Do you remember that movie?
I'm trying. No.
It's... I couldn't tell you too
much
about
it.
It's
I do like, remember it. Hold on. It's like a military facility or
no,
something?
No, see, that's another signal.
Okay.
It's a different signal, a more recent signal.
Okay. Yep. Then no, I got nothing.
But years later, when Jacob was unable to contribute to the horror anthology VHS in 2012, he suggested David, who eventually co-wrote and directed a segment called Amateur Night, which is, I believe, in my top five VHS segments. Amateur Night.
Remind me what it's about because I don't remember.
It's the siren one where they bring home that girl to the
hotel
room after
like,
the night at the... Yeah, it's a great time.
Yeah, she's fun. I really love that. Is honestly one of the best VHS segments for sure.
Yeah, I think
it might even be
the first one
from the first
in the first movie.
It might be.
Yeah,
it was all downhill.
2015. I don't know about that. He returned with another short, The Accident, for Southbound.
I'm trying to remember which segment that was though.
I don't either. I don't know.
Well, it must not have been as good as the. Well. Amateur Night.
Around then, he was rumored to be working on a Friday the 13th reboot, but he left the project.
Not enough of those.
They haven't really done it right. I didn't really dig. I might actually have to revisit the last Friday the 13th reboot. Huh. David, he really got my attention in 2017 with his film The Ritual, which we covered in episode 152.
Love.
Great film.
One of the best of the last 5 years, I would say.
Well, I wouldn't go that far.
I would.
But quite possibly.
I would for sure go that length.
And he really made it his own. Like, it had that desaturated, griefy, sleepy stuff. But then also, it like slid into these really cool, surreal moments. The dreams that kind of merge with foliage is really, really cool. I love that movie.
Yeah, that movie.
And that third act, you can't beat it. It goes wild.
I want to go back and watch that now.
I agree. And then we've got tonight's film, The Night House. In February of 2019, it was announced that Rebecca Hall would star. Principal photography began in May of 2019 in Syracuse, New York. The Night House premiered, at Sundance on January 24th of 2020, and shortly after Searchlight Pictures acquired distribution rights. It was scheduled to be released July 16th of 2021, but then was rescheduled for just a little over a month later, August 20th, 2021.
Mm-hmm.
How do you feel about The Night House?
I love it.
Start to finish.
Mostly, yeah. I mean, there was very little that I didn't like about it. It's a unique idea. Mm-hmm. It was a unique execution, you know, at the onset. Anytime a horror movie is doing something that's unique and not dumb, I'm probably going to like it for the most part.
Yeah.
But then it had really good acting and a pretty good script. And
it jumped in really in a kind of a cliche way, but it didn't feel like it. It was at a good clip. It opens with Beth, Rebecca Hall, coming home dressed in black. She's got the casserole dish. She's saying goodbye to her friend at the door, and you quickly learn that her husband killed himself.
Okay, fine.
But I mean, we've seen that in a million movies, but I like that they kind of jumped into it, leaned into that being the reality, instead of the cliche, you know?
Yeah.
Heartbroken, she starts drinking wine and watching old High 8 videos of their wedding.
Bad idea.
I rewatched this recently. I saw it in a theater first, and I had a really good time. I forgot to mention that. We usually talk about theater stuff.
Yep.
It was great.
Yeah.
I was there with like four other people.
I'm sad that I missed it in the theater, but yeah.
No complaints on my theater experience. I did go to Antlers recently and pitched a fit and shushed a crowd.
Did you?
Felt like
old
times.
How old was the crowd?
Oh, it was sad because it was like a double date for early high schoolers.
Oh, that's not sad. Tell them to fuck off and die.
Well, I don't want to be a freaking Scrooge.
It's not a Scrooge.
They're on their phones, they're talking and laughing, and I shushed.
They're rude.
Yeah, well.
Somebody needs to tell them they're not the omnipresent center of the universe.
When you see Antlers, you'll realize that it's a really sad movie. This kid is like, he's living on his own because his parents, something horrible happened to his family.
Yeah.
And he's looking at a picture of his family where he had folded his dad's head out of it, and he unfolded it, and the girl starts laughing.
You're like, what the fuck
is
wrong
with you? That's hilarious, is what I said to her.
Because God, now I wish I would have been there. It's been a long time since I've gotten to engage in theater conflict.
I know,
right? Miss that.
It is like a...
It's been like hyped up.
It's blood sports.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
It's very exciting. Here we go.
Yeah.
What I liked about this, and I'm going to talk about this several times, the subtleties of her grief are really interesting.
I agree.
She's watching back this old footage of her wedding. You can see the sadness, of course, but then also the confusion, because she doesn't see a reason that things would have ended up this way. He doesn't look sad. They look happy. And by all accounts, as we go throughout this movie, things were pretty good.
She was clearly blindsided by it.
Even though she's drinking wine, struggling to sleep, coming in and out of it, she wakes up on her side of the bed and she's tracing the area where her husband used to be. There's a knock, and Beth starts wandering the house looking for the source, sees an apparition, kind of, or a shadow, which I really like how Bruckner, I don't usually like this kind of stuff, but he frames the apparitions in really interesting ways, like using pieces of the architecture of the house to like almost form silhouettes.
Yes.
Where you're like, is that real? Is it not?
Mm-hmm.
I like that a lot. Then, bam, she wakes up and she's on the floor of her husband's office.
I think they do a really good job of capturing what I'm sure, the very almost surreal, disoriented
I can't imagine
state of mind where like weird stuff's happening, but am I dreaming? Is this real? My whole life is upside down right now. She's this fascinating conversation because she's a teacher and she's in at school and it's like
last
day of school
here. Okay,
and I loved this is one of my favorite parts of the
whole
movie.
She gets dressed, makes coffee, goes outside to get in her car, and then before she gets in there, she sees that the gate is open to her dock,
which she's weirded out by, of course.
She's trying to shake off that awful feeling, and she's still confused, like you said. But no one should have been down there, but you realize, I think pretty soon, this might be jumping the gun a little bit, but her husband killed himself. Actually, we'll get there in just a second. She shows up to the teacher's meeting, and this is where we meet her friend, her coworker, and she's like, you don't need to be here. But Beth,
she's like, I may as well. Something to think about or whatever.
I think she came back a little too soon, even though the end of the school year is kind of winding
down.
Like,
get it. Yeah.
So she's in her classroom and she's on her laptop looking at basically Zillow, trying to find new places to live. And she falls asleep sitting upright. There's a quick loss of time, which I love that Bruckner, like you're saying, Bruckner's doing a really good job of making you confused, but not like...
Not like so confused that you disconnect from it and you throw your hands up and you're like, fuck this, whatever. I'm not
going to understand
it.
You're like, I don't trust what's going on. 100%.
Right. 100%. Maybe 95%. In the same way that she probably doesn't trust what's going on because she's just so distraught right now.
Yeah. Fucking Hunter's mom shows up. When she comes in, she looks down at her laptop and there is a Googling of pistols on her laptop. So she slams it shut and begins talking with Hunter's mom, who wants her son to get a better grade because Hunter missed the final assignments. Beth said that he could make it up on the last Thursday, but Beth was out of class. That was the day that Beth's husband killed himself. Quote, he took a boat on the lake. He took a handgun I didn't even know he owned and pow, right in the mouth.
Which is amazing because honestly, it's... Parents that go in and whine about their kids' grades, I think are one of the most obnoxious groups of humans.
My mom did that for me.
Yeah, so did mine.
We have terrible parents that are also the best.
They enabled us. We love them, but they enabled us.
Mine was, I got a C in gym, and she's like, why? She went in there and
didn't run.
I probably did.
Yeah?
I probably did.
What gym teacher gave you a C?
I don't remember. Does that matter? Yeah, it does matter. Currently, right now?
It does. I'm curious. Trying to decide whether you deserved it or not.
I don't deserve
but it. But I really don't like parents that do that, especially when they come in a very accusatory manner. And I will say, every once in a while, there is a random justified case for that, but it's pretty fucking rare.
I think Rebecca Hall fucking nailed this scene. This is like one of my favorites because she's... It's layered, you know, because she's trying to hold it together. She's like, well, all right, we'll just give him a B. Sorry about that. We'll ignore the last assignment. And she's like, well, that's not what I wanted, says Hunter's mom.
And then she's kind of like, what, you wanted an A then? You've pushed me too far, bitch. Yeah. Now that's fucking it.
And that's when she tells this woman her husband killed himself.
Uh-huh.
And then once Hunter's mom leaves, you see Beth look down at a picture of her and her husband on her desk, and she, frustrated, closes it and then closes it in a drawer because, again, like, it's just such a complicated situation. Suicide of a loved one is devastated and angry. It's just more than one note grief. She comes home and the freaking gates open again, but guess what?
What?
It was Mel.
Mel's hole?
No, it was Mel, played by Vindy Curtis Hall.
I love him.
Love Mel.
He's a great character, isn't he?
Yeah, I don't really know too much about him. He was in a lot of late 80s, early 90s stuff. Die Hard 2, Falling Down, Romeo plus sign Juliet. I know you love that film. The Leonardo DiCaprio Romeo and Juliet.
It's a plus sign. Fucking cross.
I'm gonna say plus sign. He's also in Chicago Hope, the TV show, as well.
Are you gonna name the character that he plays in Romeo and Juliet?
I have no idea. It's been a very long time since I've seen that movie.
He's the police chief.
God. What? I don't have a love of that movie like you do.
Yeah, well, you should.
I think he was a really nice neighbor.
He was an excellent neighbor and a caring neighbor and a compassionate neighbor, but not in even a remotely creepy way.
No.
Very nice.
Really consistently sweet guy.
Great guy.
Yeah.
Big fan.
Digging in those tapes again, reliving parts of the relationship she had with her now dead husband, tapes of them building this house. We've got another night of drinking and boxing up Owen. I haven't said his name yet. Owen.
It's kind of an annoying name.
It's fine. Just the name of my favorite musical artist, but boxing up Owen's old things, and she discovers a book of architecture plans. He is an architect. Some odd notes, and then finally their house and a mirrored version. This is where her confusion kind of ramps up.
Yeah.
There's notes in there, like, almost, what was that? What's that? The Winchester.
Winchester?
Yeah. Like, there's notes about, like, ways to confuse, it's a lot more aesthetically pleasing architecture than what would happen in the Winchester Mystery House. But you start seeing notes like that, which is unsettling.
Well, unsettling, and again, like, really helps you stay in her mental space.
Uh-huh.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Roll it up a little.
Yeah, yeah.
There we go. It really does a good job of putting you in her mental space and feeling utterly terrified and confused about what's going on and unsure if... you're with it enough to trust yourself, or if you were so far gone that you probably just should go check into a hospital, or, you know.
Teetering. Yeah. Well, I love the house, though. It's borderline Blumhouse.
Yeah, looks I like the house, good. Too.
I think I like this house almost more than those big, gaudy, minimalist ones.
Oh, like the one from whatever that...
Well, there's the Invisible Man, there's... what else we got?
You Should Have Left, or whatever
the
that
Kevin
was.
The Kevin Bacon one? Yeah. I think that is what... Yeah, yeah.
I really liked that movie.
That house was pretty good,
That's
though.
One the further I get from, the more I like it.
I think it was trash.
No, I think it was great.
I still feel like it was a direct-to-Netflix piece of trash.
No, it was great.
A metal straw is a bad idea for podcasting, by the way. Yeah, you're doing great. Okay. So night two, woken up by the stereo playing The Cavalry Cross by Richard and Linda Thompson. And then a few seconds later, she gets a text from Owen's number. Come down.
That'd be a really weird thing to get, like when you knew your husband was dead.
I feel like this is something we've seen in other movies, but I like that it was so brief and it wasn't
like
a
text
device.
Message from the dead thing?
Yeah.
Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it wasn't a device that was overused, but music shuts itself off. She texts, "Who is this?" And then when there's no response, she calls, and a crackly voice coming through the electronics and tells her to look out the window. And it's there on the water that we see a naked Owen facing away.
Mm-hmm.
He turns to look up at Beth, and she wakes up again, this time on the floor of the bathroom, checking her phone. The text isn't there. And she could have left well enough alone.
Really? Could she?
I don't know. She could have just said, that was another dream. That was a dream. But she realizes that she has his phone in his box of belongings in her car. She plugs it in and checks it. There's no message. Mm-mm. But
no,
she starts scrolling through the images. Yeah, well, I mean, it's good detective work, I guess. Mm-hmm. There's pictures on her phone, nice memories. And then she scrolls past one of a picture that looks like her at a bookstore facing away. And yeah. She kind of smiles because she's like, that's nice. I didn't know he took this picture.
Right. But then she zooms in and she realizes it's not fucking her. She doesn't even have that shirt.
Doesn't. Which is...
But again, I think it was another moment where she's like, do I?
Do I have that shirt?
Did I forget this? Did this happen and I don't remember it? Am I completely losing my mind?
I think she pretty confidently believes that it is not her.
Correct.
So this is when she starts talking with her friends about why, what happened.
Right.
And they have an awkward night out where she's more willing to talk about what happened than her friends are.
And I have to say that I start to get a little suspicious of her friend at this point because her friend's like really encouraging her, just leave it alone, whatever. We all have our secrets. Ooh. Like, I was like, oh my God, he was totally hooking up.
I don't know. I thought it was good advice. I think her friend
wasn't bad advice, but it just, again, I think I was very much in the mental space of this poor woman and was like, something's up. Something's definitely up. Something's going on.
They're talking about, did you suspect this at all? Which I thought was really interesting because she admits that she was always the person that was depressed and he was kind of always the anchor in their relationship. Took care of both of them when she couldn't do it for them, which was really interesting. And then they talk about the suicide note, which she has in her purse.
Which is, one of those, like, pretty hard line. Okay, well, she's not in a healthy spot.
Well, the
right
envelope
now.
Has blood on it.
Yeah.
And, I mean, they're at a bar. They're like, trying to take care of her and, I guess give her a second away from all this. Yeah. That doesn't happen. The suicide note is confusing. It says, you were right. There is nothing. Nothing is after you. You're safe now. So Claire takes Beth home, and they sit on the couch talking for a while and falling asleep on the couch. Beth is woken up by a louder, not so subtle presence. There's like stereos back. Chimes are going crazy. Doors are opening.
Somebody is looking for some goddamn attention.
It's a really good jump scare, but it's not like... There's no camera work that's like whipping around really. I think it just pulls back from her face and it's more of like a sound jump scare.
Yeah.
But it's a continuous sound jump scare.
Yep.
It's like, I thought it was interesting. It was really a better take on that cliche.
Yep.
There's a disembodied voice that tells her to go outside. She grabs a jacket and a flashlight. And this is kind of a ritual moment, the way they light it. She's out there walking around in not the woods, but like towards her edge of the property. And then suddenly there's young women running past her, kind of through her. jumping over a fence and into the lake off of a cliff.
Yeah, it's very clear that there's something going on and she's seeing it, but like, is she dreaming it?
Mm-hmm. And then she sees lights on in a house across the lake. And she says, if you're with me, show me. She closes her eyes. And then when she opens them up, there's bloody footprints on the dock. And then her cheek is grazed. And this really, the way they do ghost touch in this is so cool.
It reminded me a little bit of Invisible Man.
A little bit.
But more subtle than that.
It's subtle, but also there's like elements that go along with it, like breezes or like audio maybe too at the same time. But it does a lot more than just like, Rebecca Hall's an incredible actress, but it's not all on her shoulders either. Like there's other things that add to this presence, which are really cool. I don't know.
Yeah.
I really like that.
I agree. I think that also, yeah, I think that the combination of cinematography, like very light special effects,
yeah,
screenplay and acting worked really, really well together.
Is that really you? And then bam, a force knocks her unconscious backwards into the boat.
Yep.
You know, that moment almost reminded me of, remember when they come in the window and you're next and things go into slow motion?
No.
Yeah, well, it's kind of like that.
I need to rewatch it. I only saw that once.
I saw it in the theater. I think it was for my birthday. We watched that. It's like a big birthday party when I had friends back in the day.
I don't remember those days for myself.
Me either, hardly. The boat drifts in the moonlight across the lake to the other shore. The night house. The night house is their house, but flipped. Which is interesting because
Mirror. This
is where I think the trailer was really effective at pointing us in a wrong direction. I thought this was going to be something completely different than what it is.
And yep. I agree. Which is part of, like, I'm not even sure I want people to listen to this if they haven't watched it.
We might break here in a second. I do have a couple more things I want to talk about. But I agree. Like, there's something really unique about the way they marketed this.
I just don't want people to ruin it for themselves, primarily.
You gotta really heed her words here, because it's time for dead giveaways. This is the point in the show where we spoil parts of a movie. If you haven't seen The Night House, where the hell have you been? What are you, Byron and Kelly?
I don't even know.
Come on, guys, watch it.
I don't even know.
And then when you feel comfortable, pick up with us now.
No, but really.
Yeah.
Like, if you haven't watched it, just go away.
Beth sees a woman that looks a lot like herself and a guy that looks like Owen fighting in the window. When she goes inside, it's daytime and she sees herself sleeping on the couch. From the other perspective of the couch person, she just sees the door open. Another, like, increasingly layered confusion.
Yep.
Which I love.
But without getting super stupid, annoying special effects.
This isn't Oculus.
Yeah. I mean, I like Oculus.
I know you
do. I don't know why you're so mean about Oculus.
Well, I think that this transition is a lot more necessary than a lot of the stuff that Mike Flanagan has done. But I haven't seen a lot of the more recent stuff. I haven't seen the Netflix shows. So.
Okay. Well, yeah, sure.
Determined to find the night house again, she goes on a hike where she bumps into her neighbor Mel and his dog. And he's kind of nice, but he also tells her straight up, he's very blunt, you're not well, Beth. He doesn't want her out there by herself.
Right. Like, hey, this is, I'm a little worried.
Like her friend Claire, this is where I'm like, what is going on? Who are these people? What do they know?
Yep.
Mel's a little bit more genuine, but it almost makes you wonder more.
I always trusted him. I did not trust
Claire.
Her.
Maybe, I don't know.
I think that's my own thing.
But she does find, she finds kind of the house. It's not the house that she saw in her dream. It's in the middle of construction. It's a bit run down.
Right.
And inside of it, she finds a bound figure impaled with nails inside of a bucket.
It's just super strange.
Kind of witchy shit.
Yeah. It was very, very strange.
She returns back and she bumps into Mel and she asks Mel what he knows. Because
and at first Mel doesn't want to tell her.
Anything.
No, he really he just wants to let dead husbands lie.
Well, yeah. Turns out he knew Owen had been out there, and he actually caught him once with another woman, and that he had urges, shameful urges.
Which we think means one thing.
Yeah, you know, we do.
We think means that thing.
So she starts looking for the source of the weird books. He's trying to figure out who the girl is and who her husband is. Actually, yes. The place is Books and Melodies LLC. She does this after looking through his laptop and finding more photos of women who look similar to her. She identifies that statue as one from the book. So, yeah, she determines that Owen was trying to learn how to trick and trap demonic entities.
Which seems very incongruent with what she knew about her husband.
It's
not. He wasn't a weirdo.
No, he's never talked about. Well, so she has another weird, noisy night, another apparition. It's kind of like a Hitchcockian, like, side shot with the, what's that stuff? The molding of a entryway?
Oh, yeah.
I only say Hitchcockian because of the silhouette.
I got it. Looks like Hitchcock's silhouette, yeah, literally. Yeah. Okay.
Next day, she goes to the bookstore, confronts a woman. The one in the picture, it's Madeline. They have a very uncomfortable
real conversation. Awkward. Which is funny because, again, our heroine here just seems to really, she's definitely adopted a fuck it mentality towards everything. She really doesn't care.
Yeah.
If she weirds out her friends while she's drinking at the bar and pulls out the suicide note with blood on it, she really doesn't care if she weirds out this chick who was obviously hooking up with her husband. She doesn't mind making people feel uncomfortable. She's totally good with it. She's like, whatever.
It's kind of a fucking fun message. I almost like it.
Yeah. She's very authentic, Byron.
Ooh, is that what that is?
Mm-hmm.
So Beth leaves and she visits Claire, who asks her to spend a few days away from the house. This is more suspicious Claire behavior.
Yeah.
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 And Beth agrees and then heads home to pack, where she threatens the ghost in the house. While packing, Madeline shows up and they have a little sit down at the table. They talk about the relationship that she had with Owen, as well as the weird things he did and almost did to her.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he almost hurt her. And when she stopped him, that's when he decided that he needed to let her go.
Which, yeah, again, I kind of was like, all right, well, I guess that makes sense a little bit, but also
here in a second we'll figure out that maybe that doesn't make as much sense. But yeah, he had to end it for good with something that he shared with Madeline,
which, again, not super cool to share it with her, but okay.
Yeah, no, Madeline leaves, and in the rain Beth returns to the night house, where she discovers something horrifying under the floorboards. We'll give you a pause for a second. Dead giveaways.
Another? We already did it, didn't we?
Yeah, but this is...
This is deader.
This is the deadest of giveaways, probably.
Most
of... Well, second deadest.
Dead.
Under the floorboards, she finds a bunch of bagged up dead bodies. Which I fucking loved. This is when the movie is
off,
like,
the rails. What the fuck's going on?
I was happy it wasn't 100% supernatural. Having seen the trailer, having my expectations flipped on their head with this film already, and then this happens, like, the most grounded situation, where, like, holy shit, Owen's a serial killer. He's got all these dead bodies in this house that's real on the other side.
Right, that looks like their house.
Kind of.
The opposite of.
Yeah, like, this is real. This isn't supernatural, and it's not really in her head. And also, this is, like, another opportunity where Rebecca really showed her chops, because, you know, she goes back home, and she sits with all of this, like...
And it's like, what is going on?
More than anything, I think she says something like, I wish I wrote it down. She says something like, I wish you were here. I really need you here. Something like that. Because imagine like having just that many questions about someone after their death, and then having all these very confusing, very dark things.
Right. Like, and she's had this interaction with who she assumes is her husband at this point.
Yep. Yep.
Right. And she's like, in a certain way, it's even one step beyond, oh, I wish you were here, but it's like, no, really, I know you can be here. I need you to be here right now. We got to talk about this.
That's kind of it. But she's just, it's just the same collection of emotions amplified that we've been feeling throughout this whole thing, which is cool, because she's not, oh God, she's not scared, but she's disgusted.
I think she's scared.
You think so?
I think she's scared.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm going with scared.
She looks up and she sees here written in the steam of the mirror. Mm-hmm. And we got one more weird night. Beth embraces what she thinks is Owen. It is not.
No, in fact, he actually goes ahead and lets her know.
The demon shows her visions of Owen murdering a bunch of girls.
Yep, and now we know that there's a problem.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I guess we knew there was a problem because there were bodies, but now we know there's a different kind of
different
problem.
Different problem.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
And this is where things escalate into a surreal, twisty nightmare. Mm-hmm. Kind of like what I was expecting to see, and I kind of hope to see David bring into this, is like he really uses, like in the same way we were talking about the gas station and the ritual, he takes advantage of this moment to like do some weird visual shit, which I really enjoyed.
Yeah.
And I mean, twisty stuff, like he literally levitates her off the ground and bends her in the shape of that twisty doll, which is pretty fun. I don't know. Do you want to talk more about what happens that night, or let's leave that up in the
air? I mean, I feel like what happens that night, I don't want there to be any risk of somebody hearing this without watching it.
Sure.
And B, I just don't think it sounds anything other than stupid when you say it out loud, like kinda what the upshot ends up being.
Yeah.
The problem is I really like what the resolution was. We haven't talked about it. I don't know if you liked
it was weak. That's funny. Okay. Yeah.
See,
but you could see why I would think that. And I could see why you would.
It's not your jam.
Yeah.
It's my jam. Spoiler alert.
Sure.
It's a really, really interesting. I haven't seen it before. Yeah. It was a really.
I agree.
Was a very cool approach.
For a third act of a film that has been escalating throughout, this it is shocking to take the turn that they did,
yep.
Which almost, in a way, I don't know.
Yeah.
De-escalates is what I was going to say.
I mean, but I don't know that it de-escalates it. I think it's just,
it's a different emotion.
Yeah.
Kelly, what you think about this?
Well, this is one that you kept telling me to watch, you know, like... Mm-hmm. A bunch of times you told me,
yeah.
And I said to myself, I'm sure I'll watch it. It looks good. I actually do remember saying like, okay, I really want to maybe go to the theater to see this one.
I see that you're looking at Christmas sweaters through the reflection of your glasses.
I'm actually not looking at Christmas sweaters. Believe it or not, I'm looking at a specific Christmas gift for you.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. It's now, not.
Now
Christmas
I'm really
sweater.
Trying to figure
it
out.
It was red.
Yeah, I see okay. that. All right.
I should have listened to you earlier because it was really good.
Yeah.
And I really do wish I had seen it in the theater. But Sam and I watched it in Oregon, and it was actually kind of fun and spooky. So there's a really big storm outside.
It was weird when Sam was standing on the water naked looking away.
Super weird. Yeah, I like woke up in the middle of the night that night and I looked out and in the ocean he was just like standing down there, and I was like, you're gonna scare people, come back up here, what are you
come
doing
up here, dude, that's illegal.
Jesus, that's so weird. No, but there's a storm outside and we were watching it on our laptop because there wasn't a TV in the room, and like
sure.
we were trying to be super quiet because the kids were right next door and we didn't want to scare the hell out of them. I don't know, it was just a fun way to watch it, I guess. I love it. I'm down for this. I think that this is a movie that, I don't know why a lot of people didn't talk about it, but it will be on my list for the end of the year. You mark my words. I guess that's only like a month and a half out, isn't it?
Yeah, the end of year list that we need to work on. And then after that, we got to start doing the March Madness brackets again.
Oh, God, who are we going to do this year?
I don't know. It'll be fun, but...
I don't think I like it. Anyhow, this was amazing. I kind of want you to give your score first because I'm worried you're going to judge me.
I don't give a shit what you give.
You're sure?
You got to consider the audience, though. They give a shit.
I give The Night House... 9.1 Kindly Old Neighbors. Don't be mad at me. I really liked it.
Kelly, I'm not mad at you.
You're a little mad.
No, I'm a Rebecca-holic.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I love Rebecca Hall. I think she's incredible. I really enjoyed the use of the handheld camera footage in this as well. We didn't really talk too much about this. The Hi-8 tapes, the glimpses of Owen that...
Oh, right. I was like, wait, when was that?
Wait,
but no, I know what you're talking about.
It added like a layer to this that I enjoyed. And we didn't talk too much about Owen, played by Evan Jean-Yves Keat.
Nope.
No idea.
I'm not even going to try.
But yeah, he was in Bone Tomahawk and Whiskey Tango, Foxtrot, and The Empty Man, which you really enjoyed as well. While I did enjoy the surreal elements of the ritual better, I did, again, think it was nice that David brought that back to this film's third act. The darkness, the heaviness, the grief.
The nothing.
They show it in a really different way. It's really a unique take on the grief industry that we've found ourselves in. It's not A24 level grief porn. The resolution I thought was kind of it dulled the shock of the heaviness of the center, but you know, the point of the film isn't to really, it's a story about grieving, not grief.
Oh, I like that. That's very poetic. It is.
And for all those reasons, I
guess. It's also a story about having a serial killer husband.
Yeah.
Don't forget that part.
How could I? I give The Night House 7.7 women that look like my wife.
Yeah, I have to say that would creep and piss me the fuck off.
Well, it's like Claire said, it's better than, I hope her name is Claire. I've been calling her Claire this whole time. Yeah. It's better than a woman that doesn't look like you at all. Right?
Yeah, that's true.
Those are our thoughts on The Night House, which is available now everywhere, probably physically, but most absolutely digitally. So if you haven't seen it, do it. But if you are this far and you haven't seen it, you really didn't listen to us and you possibly ruined the movie.
Yeah, you made a bad choice. Because,
but you could still enjoy it, I think.
Well, I guess. I mean, hopefully we didn't completely ruin it for you, but mostly you need to just not.
You ready for Bruckner's Hellraiser coming out next year?
Yeah, I was looking at that. It's got another Succession. It's got one of the main characters from Succession in it.
Everything's tying back. Who's that one? The guy from ER?
No, the lady, the woman.
Oh, wow.
The dark hair, she plays the...
Playing Pinhead?
She plays the patriarch's wife in the movie.
Wow. So I'm looking forward to that, even though, again, I just don't give a shit about Hellraiser. It's like not even
You know what
thing.
I really want to do? And I think I've talked about this before. I don't even know if anybody would ever want to listen to that. But The Thief of Always, I really think is like the coolest, most fun book. The I feel Thief like we just need Always. To do a series where I just read a chapter of it every week.
Well, we tried to do that with the Wendigo once. Remember, we did one part.
I know,
of the
that
Wendigo?
Was really difficult to read, though.
Yeah, it was a bit of a ye old, right?
Yeah, it was super ye old, and it was just difficult to listen to and read. But I could do The Thief of Always. I mean, until we got yelled at for copyright, I
no
could.
One will give a shit. But yeah, once you've seen this movie, let us know what you thought about it. You could reach out to us on social media at Twitter.
I feel like I have a good reading voice. The girls say that I'm good at reading stories, and I can do voices.
Well, your voices are. Usually at Frightday on Twitter and Instagram. You could leave a comment below this episode in the show notes at Frightday.com or send us an email, contact@Frightday.com, or we can have a talk in the Facebook group, facebook.com/group/Frightday or discord.frightday.com, the Discord server. That's my favorite place to be. If you like this show and want to help us make it even better, grab something spooky at shop.frightday.com.
Christmas time.
I think it's about time for us to drop that new shirt that we've been talking about for a while. We got to, you know what?
Black Friday sale.
What do we call it?
Bike a present.
What are we doing this?
We're doing a...
Let's do promo code FEAST.
Oh, like Thanksgiving feast?
It's surrounding the Thanksgiving holiday, the feast. Kelly. We'll call it the feast.
What if we call it...
What?
Stolen lands.
Oh, right.
What if we call it that? Can we call it that?
Let's not do that.
Pilgrims weren't nice.
Turkey month. Promo code Turkey Month.
Yeah.
That'll get you 30% off. Why not? Let's go big.
Are we going big?
Yeah, let's go
Is
big.
Is there even a fucking profit margin if you do that?
I don't really care.
God, have you ever even done the math to find that out?
Yeah, usually once a year I do.
Oh, my God.
Go to shop.frightday.com. Promo code Turkey Month.
My.
And we may be fueled by Spring Hill Jack Coffee, but it's the members of the Frightday Society who, what are the members keeping us right now?
Well fed on Thanksgiving.
Okay, I guess so, if we're sticking with
that theme. They keep Byron trying new Thanksgiving foods every year.
There's
maybe
really
this
not that
year
much to try.
He will try stuffing.
Who knows? I could.
Could go crazy.
Wow, I'm not doing that. When you join the Frightday Society at patreon.com/Frightday, what do you get? You get a new episode each week. It's called Behind the Screams, but this week, it's a little bit more special than that. It's a conversation with our old good friend.
It is.
Seth Breedlove is back. Something happened to Seth, and Kelly needed to talk to him immediately.
I did need to talk to him immediately.
It's an hour-long, I would say one-sided conversation of Kelly shouting it at Seth about seeing a Bigfoot.
Well, I mean, I wasn't really shouting. I was very excited.
It's going to be popping up on the feed for the Society members. If you haven't seen his Bigfoot project... yet. Available now on the Small Town Monsters YouTube channel. Check it out. But yeah, also episodes of Byron Serial Corner, The Writer's Room, Toast to Toast PM with Wine Kelly, Captain Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies, Cinema Autopsy, and the first 10 episodes of this podcast. That's a whole bunch of stuff. Hours available to you if you become a member of the Frightday Society. You also get access to members-only products, as well as early access to new things, and 15% off everything at shop.frightday.com. But that doesn't matter, because it's Turkey Month. Promo code 30%. I'd like to welcome and initiate some new folks. Welcome, Faith.
Faith, it's a great time of year to have you come on board.
Faith, I need you. All right, I see what you're doing.
Yep, you like that?
Faith, I need you to go talk to my gym teacher, like my mom did, and get my grade lowered, because I didn't deserve a B.
You really don't remember who it was?
I don't, and it does not matter one single ounce.
I feel like it matters.
No, no one cares.
Faith, I'm going to give you something much cooler to do than
that. I like
that
one. Give that one to our next person here.
No, that is totally,
like to
totally
welcome,
stupid.
Well, most of them are. We don't need to assign homework to everyone.
No, we do need to assign homework to people. I would like you to please find the scariest thing that's ever happened in your hometown and email it to us.
Oh my God, it's so boring.
No, it isn't. It could be a historical thing that is real, uh-huh. like some murder, or it could be like a ghost thing, or it could be, you know, like maybe you live near Plymouth Rock and it was when the white people came and started
Jesus.
Killing all the Indians.
All
right. I don't know.
I'd like to welcome and initiate another folk here. Singular folk. I don't usually say a folk. That's interesting.
I wonder where that's coming from.
Taylor A.
Ooh, hi, Taylor A.
Taylor A, I need you to go change my grade back.
No, stop it.
After she's done, I do want my GPA to remain where it was. What? What do you want to do?
Oh, my God.
You want to go to a bookstore?
No, what
go
I
to
would...
an occult bookstore. Do something relating to the movie.
No, no.
That's usually what I do.
No, I don't. Why relate it to the movie?
Because it's
to
fun.
To the movie? No, it doesn't need to be the movie. No.
It doesn't need to be boring.
I would like you to please do a little bit of research into the history of, what's that famous architect, Wright? The one that, like, everybody, you know, the freaking Wright. I need you to do some research into Frank Lloyd Wright, and I want you to find something spooky about his architectural motivations. There's got to be something spooky about him.
Okay, cool.
Because he did things so differently and was, you know, I don't know if he was an asshole or not, but
maybe
I think he got something for us. So, you know, let me know if there's something there worth doing a report on.
Okay, well, if you want to join like those two folks did, Patreon, cult.frightday.com or patreon.com/frightday. Join the society. The FDS. I've been wanting to call it that. Isn't that kind of fun?
I kind of like that.
Yeah, I agree. Are you writing the letter to everyone?
I am.
That's very nice. You're writing the letter to the inner circle, I see.
I am.
Very cool. You guys are the best. Thanks for listening to the podcast, as always. It means a lot. I enjoy hearing your thoughts about our show. I don't know what we're doing.
What are we?
The food eating holiday, Camp Fright Day. So much coming up so quick. Episode 300. Still not sure what we're doing with that. But Kelly, until then.
I feel like we should act out 300.
The movie?
Yeah, I'll
That's
be Gerard
Jacob
Butler.
Said. You want that?
Sometimes Jacob and I, we're like sine and cosine waves, yeah. But every once in a while we
you
fucking
meet.
Match up.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep.
Until next week though, Kelly, where are you going
to
be?
Yeah, I'm listening to a lot of Baggins, like old interviews, like from 15 years ago. It's really fun.
Are we going to?
What if we get Baggins for Camp Friday?
I reached
Can
out to
get
his
me
manager.
Baggins?
I will follow up.
Get me Baggins.
All right. Okay.
Tell him I got some pants to send him.
I was. So this is. Not on the podcast. I want to start making enamel pins that have to do with our bigger projects, like a Montauk pin that we could sell like in tandem with the Montauk stuff. Or I was going to do complicated pants for the Baggins project, which that would come late, but
that's
why
great.
Not just
I
do
love it.
It.
There are some really fun things. We
Did
can
you
do
say
for
Kelly at Frightday.com?
Oh, yeah. You can find me at Kelly Frightday on Twitter, KellyFrightday.com.
Great.
And eating some pie.
Very nice. And I'm at Byron McKoy on Twitter and Instagram. Byron at Frightday.com is my email address. And until next Frightday, where we're going to be talking the scary of 61st.
Yeah, very scary.
I'm Byron.
I'm Kelly. Stay out of that original car wreck, Beth.
And stay scared.
You've been listening to an Audio Wool original, produced by Byron McKoy. Theme music provided by Cemeteries. For more programs like this, visit audiowool.co.